Discuss Morera's theorem. The statement of the theorem is, if fz be continuous in a simply connected domain D, and if integral over C fz dz is equal to 0, where C is any rectifiable closed Jordan curve in D, then fz is analytic in D. This theorem is also called converse of Cauchy-Gossert theorem. The statement of Cauchy-Gossert theorem is, if fz is analytic, then integral over C fz dz will be 0. And here, these are the given conditions. Fz be continuous, integral over C fz dz is 0, where C is any rectifiable closed Jordan curve in D, then fz is analytic. So, these are the given conditions. Fz is continuous, integral over C fz dz equal to 0. We have to prove that fz is analytic in D, where D is a simply connected domain containing C, where C is rectifiable closed Jordan curve in D. Proof. Suppose these are the two points z0 and z. Let z0 be a fixed point and z be a variable point in D. And let C1, C2 be any two continuous rectifiable curves in D joining Z0 to Z. This is the curve C1 and this is the curve C2 joining Z0 to Z. Let C denote the closed rectifiable continuous curve consisting of C1 and minus C2. C1 and minus C2. If this is C2, then this is minus C2. So C is the closed curve containing C1 and minus C2. Then according to the given condition, it is given that integral over C fz dz equal to 0. This will imply integral over C1 fz dz plus integral over minus C2 fz dz equal to 0 by properties of line integration. And this will imply integral over C1 fz dz minus integral over C2 fz dz equal to 0 again by property of line integral. And this will imply integral over C1 fz dz is equal to integral over C2 fz dz. This shows that the integral along every curve in D joining z0 and z is the same, taking xi as the variable of integration. We can write capital fz equal to integral over from z0 to z in the form of definite integration. Integral from z0 to z f xi dxi, where xi is the variable of integration. Suppose number one, let z plus h be a point in D close to the point z. Then from one, one is fz equal to integral from z0 to z f xi dxi. So fz plus h will be integral from z0 to z plus h. Now upper limit will be z plus h because in fz the upper limit is z. So for fz plus h, the lower limit will be z0 but upper limit will be z plus h f xi dxi. Suppose equation number 2. Now subtracting 1 from 2. We get fz plus h minus fz. This will be equal to integral z0 to z plus h fxi dxi minus integral z0 to z fxi dxi. And this can be written as, on changing the limit, this will be positive. So it is integral z to z0 fxi dxi plus integral z0 to z plus h fxi dxi. And by property of definite integration, this will be the integral from z to z plus h fxi dxi. Suppose equation number 3. Since the integral in 3 is path independent, as we have already proved that integral over c1 equal to integral over c2. So the integration, the function fz, integral of the function fz is path independent. Since the integral in 3 is path independent, it may be taken along the straight line segment joining z to z plus h, not along any curve. but we have taken the integration along a straight line, segment joining z to z plus h. Hence, fz plus h minus fz by h minus fz. We are taking this expression. So, its value is, it is 1 by h times, integral from z to z plus h fxi dxi. 1 by h, integral from z to z plus h fxi dxi minus fz, we have multiplied and divided it by h. So finally it will be fz. And this can be written as 1 by h, by taking a 1 by h in common, integral z to z plus h fxi minus fz dxi. Here fz is constant with respect to the variable xi, because the variable of integration is xi. So z, fz is constant. So finally this will reduce to 1 by h integral of z to z plus h fxi dxi minus 1 by h fz times dxi, and integration of dxi will be xi from upper limit minus lower limit, it will convert to h. So we shall get fz into h. So we can write it equal to 1 by h integral z to z plus h fxi minus fz dxi. Suppose it equation number 4. Since fxi is continuous by the given condition, fz be continuous in d. So fxi is continuous. So for given epsilon greater than 0, there exists a number delta greater than 0 such that mod fxi minus fz is less than epsilon, suppose number 5. For all xi for which mod xi minus z is less than delta, by definition of continuity, we choose h such that mod h is less than delta. Then from 4 and 5, we have taking mod of this expression, mod of fz plus h minus fz by h minus small fz. This will be less than equal to 1 by, because this will be equal to mod of this. And mod of integral is less than equal to integral of the mod. So this is less than equal to 1 upon mod h times integral z to z plus h mod of fz fxi minus fz mod of dxi. And this will be less than 1 by mod h. This is less than epsilon from 5. So this replaces mod fz fxi minus fz, epsilon replace mod fxi minus fz, and finally we shall get integral of mod dxi, that will give xi, mod xi as integration. And from upper limit and lower minus lower limit, this will be equal to 1 by mod h epsilon mod z plus h minus mod z, upper limit minus lower limit. And this will be less than 1 by mod h epsilon times mod z plus mod h minus mod z. So finally it is left with equal to epsilon, because plus minus mod z cancel out and mod h will be cancelled out with mod h. So we are left with only epsilon. Suppose it equation number 6. And this is the definition of limit. Whenever we say that mod fz minus a small fz is less than epsilon, it means limit of capital fz is equal to small fz. So limit of this is equal to this, where h tends to 0. So this implies limit h tending to 0, fz plus h minus fz by h is equal to fz. And this gives the derivative of fz, capital fz. So this is f dash z, which is equal to fz, which holds for every z in D, and this shows that fz is analytic in D. This proves the theorem. Okay, thank you very much.